All right, so we're going to talk about kudzu bugs. As I mentioned, we've been experiencing this insect for several years now in the southeast, and I'm going to kind of take you through just about the entire history of it being here and what we found out about it. All right, just a little bit about the species and what it looks like. You've got egg masses laid in two rows. The immatures hatch from those and develop through five instars, much like stink bugs, and before they become adults. Give you an idea about the size of the adults. They're about the size of an eraser on a pencil, you know, about the same size as a lady beetle. It's unlike anything else you will see in soybeans. Now, you will see this insect in large numbers on non-legume hosts. It'll rest on anything in large numbers and almost look like it's feeding and hurting that host plant. But its preferred host are legumes. Soybeans, kudzu is a legume, wisteria is a legume, peanuts is a legume, but interestingly, this insect doesn't like peanuts. You can find it on peanuts, but it doesn't use it as a reproductive host. Kudzu is its preferred wild host. The kudzu bug, incidentally, is not its approved common name. That's just what we call it because if you go in a kudzu patch, it's in the kudzu patch in an infested area. So you're going to find it on kudzu first. It's actually a good guy on kudzu. There's a published paper already that it reduces kudzu growth by 30%. So it's actually a biocontrol agent of kudzu. Not going to eradicate kudzu, not going to get rid of kudzu, it just feeds on it, slows the growth down. Kudzu occurs in a very large portion of the United States, pretty much where we grow soybeans, the whole eastern half of the country. So those two hosts overlap nicely for this insect. This is a video one of my graduate students took about, I don't know, a dozen sweeps in an infested area of this field. It's pretty dramatic. You see these things just boiling out of the sweep net. You can find it early. This is an early May picture. Those are just early vegetative soybeans like V2, and they're just covering every stalk in the field. Pretty abundant quick. And at the end of the season, they can be really, really thick if you don't do anything about it. All right, this is where kudzu bug is from. It's from Asia. That's where we get a lot of our invasive species. But they've been here since 2009. They're found on some homes next to a kudzu patch. This insect likes the color white. So it's going to be on your truck if it's white. It's going to be on your house, the trim work if it's white. It was limited to these nine counties in northeast Georgia in 2009. We checked around, and this was the limit of its distribution in late 2009. This is a picture of where we got at the end of last year, 2013. It's in multiple states, infested South Carolina, North Carolina, most of Georgia, all of Alabama. It's into Mississippi, and it's over to the river, and it's just a matter of time before you got it here in Arkansas. Some of the limitations that you can imagine for distribution of this insect, probably the mountain ranges here, but it's going to be just a matter of time before this thing funnels up and gets into some big soybean acres, and then it'll be limited probably by temperature only. This is kudzu, the terminal growth of kudzu, and this is what happens when kudzu starts to green up. They start laying egg masses around the terminals and start colonizing this favorite host plant. And then you've already seen this picture. They can move straight into soybeans. If you get early planted soybeans, this insect doesn't have to have kudzu to survive. As long as there are early planted soybeans, it'll come straight out of overwintering sites as adults and move right into early planted soybeans. So I think you've got kind of a perfect storm set up for this insect out here in the mid-south. Then it migrates in large numbers to soybeans about midsummer. And it can get very abundant early on. The eggs are laid primarily under leaves, and you can find a lot of egg masses out there. It's very distinct, two rows. The nymphs have this kind of fuzzy appearance. All right, so how does this insect feed? It's not a leaf chewer. It doesn't feed on the pods. This thing is a stem feeder, much like the three-cornered alfalfa hopper. It just feeds on the stems, the petioles, and it's a stress-inducing pest. It's another factor out there that's stressing the plant. It takes a while for the populations to get going to put enough stress on the plant to hurt yield. All right, so we've done a lot of work on treatment thresholds and some of this maturity group plant date work, and I don't have a lot of that work summarized yet. We've got to do more analyses on that to kind of nail down a threshold, but we've looked at things like an untreated control, full protection, one bug per sweep, two bugs per sweep, one bug per sweep when nymphs present, and then a single application at beginning pod fill, pod formation. And what we found out is that the key is to control the nymphs, control the reproducing populations. If you can get in front of a population that's trying to develop in the field, you can do a pretty good job. We're going to have a number to put with that recommendation here pretty soon, but in this publication, we pretty much read that you've got to time the applications for nymphs. One nymph per sweep using a sweep net, or I personally like an observation threshold where you go in the field and you just push back the canopy and look. And if you can easily see hatching nymphs on most of your observations, it's time to spray. And once you kind of hit those things hard, you can evaluate later, and once nymphs come back, the second generation, you hit them again. So the pyrethroids provide good control. There is going to be some reinfestation, particularly if you spray too early, and we showed some evidence that you probably don't need to spray too early. Don't let kudzu bugs complete a generation on soybeans. The immatures are definitely important, and I really like this observation threshold. All right, so more information can be found at kudzubug.org or our Clemson website, and I think that's pretty much it.